thank you so much for joining us this afternoon as we look, and morning for some of you, as we look at FDA's Bioresearch Monitoring Program, the inspection of sponsors, CROs, and monitors. So the FDA has compliance program guidance manuals that they put together to give instruction to their employees to go out and do inspections for different groups. This one particularly, they're called compliance program guidance manuals. This one particularly focuses on that for an inspection of sponsors, CROs, and monitors. And we fall under the FDA's Bioresearch Monitoring Program, or BIMO. So what we'll talk about today, and we have a lot of material in the slides that are for your reference. Some of it may be applicable to you, some of it may not be, but we want to make sure that we have information there to cover some of those things for you. Certainly, the FDA, when they come in, these are the things that they'll be doing at a bare minimum. So it's a great tool for us to get a sense of, you know, are we ready for an inspection? Do we have, or do our vendors have, these procedures and processes in place? So we'll look at how new regulatory requirements are being incorporated into inspections. We'll look at the compliance program guidance manual and the rules that support changes in the inspection focus. We'll look at FDA's application of the inspection manual contents as reflected in regulatory communication. So what we are seeing, how the FDA is pulling out information, putting it in their warning letters, for example. And we'll look at steps for preparation of an inspection. So this compliance program guidance manual was updated in April of 2017. So it is the most recent update. We had changes to 7348.811 in December of 2008. That was followed by changes for 7348.810, which we'll be discussing now, in March of 2010, then November of 2010 for 7348.809 for IRBs. And then finally, we had this update, which really incorporated a lot of information to the changes to the final rule for registering our studies on clinicaltrials.gov. So how many of you are familiar with these compliance program guidance manuals? Can you give me a green check if you are, or a red X if not, please? All right, great, thanks. So I always say that these are the answers to the test questions. This is what the FDA is expecting when they come in, so this is what they're going to inspect. Vice versa. So if we look at quality systems at the site and CRO level, we know that ICH E6 updated under revision 2 requires us to have, or as much as ICH requires us to have, quality management systems. But the FDA has been pushing this for quite some time. Even though it is not outlined per se in the regulations, we see that systems need to be in place, and some systems need to be in place to support those sponsor responsibilities. So within each of these, we have processes. So when we're looking at quality systems, we're looking at the systems, subsystems, and processes that support it so that we can meet that ultimate goal for a sponsor of ensuring that our trial is well conducted, there's oversight, and we get that ultimate product, if you will, of good data from protected subjects. So sponsor quality systems, organization and personnel, who are your people? What are they doing? Are they qualified to do it? Vendor selection, oversight, and management. If you are not capable of performing these tasks in-house or you have decided to outsource them, how do you select and vet your vendors? How do you make sure that they are qualified, and how do you oversee them? Monitoring activities and procedures. We know the regulations require us to ensure proper monitoring. How do you go about doing that? How do you collect and handle data? How do you ensure the integrity of your safety and efficacy data? How is data flowing to you? Investigational product accountability and integrity. So the FDA's jurisdiction lies with that investigational product. How do you control it, make sure it's only given to participating investigators, and it's being used in accordance with the approved protocol? Record retention, generation, integrity. How are those documents being used? Have you defined which documents are regulatory in nature? Are they being maintained in a manner that is compliant with Part 11, if necessary, for example, and that they will be available for review if the FDA comes and wants to see them? And then finally, the expectation for all of us is having a process to bring ourselves voluntarily back into compliance. We know non-compliance happens. I always say it's what you do with it that makes or breaks you. The FDA is looking to see how we're dealing with issues, how we are maybe dealing with our vendors, and any issues that they might have.